Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful, where streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name when I'm found in the desert place, though I walk through the wilderness. Blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name.
Checked out that turkey that's running around in the gathering space. Oh my gosh. It just cracks me up. So if you see me laughing up here, it's because I'm seeing the turkey running
He's all
around.
Stuffed.
Welcome, welcome. I invite you to sing along with us. Beautiful Savior.
Days, I will sing this song of gladness.
Youth representative forward to give us a few words about the trip coming. There's a trip, right?
Hi, my name is Xander, and I'm going to Houston, Texas this June for the 2018 National Youth Gathering. We're going to help the victims of Hurricane Harvey. There's going to be around 30,000 high school youth going. From our youth group in particular, there will be 19, 16 youth and 3 advisors. Please pray for safe travel and open hearts. Pray for the volunteers that are giving up their time. Pray that this congregation will come together to help us get there. The cost of this trip is over $1,000 per person, so we're asking our Trinity family for some financial help. Check out the bulletin board in the gathering space. If you can, please take an envelope, fill it with the dollar amount listed, and put it in the offering plate during the service, or you can drop it off at the church office. This bulletin board will be in the gathering space for the next few weeks, and all of the money raised will go directly to us attending the youth gathering. I am thankful for Trinity and its continued focus on the youth of this church. This YG has really helped me strengthen my faith, so thank you for helping us participate in what I know will be an amazing trip. Now here we have a quick video about our trip and the fundraiser. Thank you. I'm excited just to be with like 30,000 other Lutherans.
I'm really excited to go to Houston and serve because of all the natural disasters that have been happening down there. People need our help more than ever, and previous mission trips have definitely changed my life, so I'm really excited.
Spending time with our youth group is always just a fantastic time.
I think this will help and grow my faith, just, you know, whenever I grow up, and it'll help in my leadership skills.
This is my third mission trip, and one thing that I always get out of it every time is that, you know, even in the most dire situations and in the places that you would feel are, like, the most hopeless, you always see God's light and you see how the other people around you are touching this community and how the community is thanking you, and it's always just so uplifting.
Learn and serve God the best that I can, to the best of my ability.
You know, I get to go on a trip and hang out with my friends, but it also gives us all the opportunity to go help people who maybe need more help.
Pray for the planners.
Pray for Peter Fox as he organizes and takes on this trip to Houston.
For the pastors to find the right words to inspire me.
Good morning. So we can help out the youth get to Houston, right? All right, let's get them there. Just a couple of announcements. We're very pleased that you're gathered here with us to worship today. My name is Pastor Jack Corner, and on behalf of the congregation, I want to welcome you to worship. We're going to have Pastor Brock with us in a little while, and he's going to be offering the message, Invest Wisely. Please fill out the worship witness pads that are in the pews and the seats and pass them along to your neighbor. We would appreciate that. Today is also a special day for the Barrows family for the baptism of Charlotte, daughter of Scott and Madeline. So it's wonderful to have you with us today, and we're really looking forward to being able to share the sacrament of baptism with you as well. Following this service, we will have our healing service at 12:30 in the chapel for all those who need healing prayer. This is a service that's held the third Sunday of every month, and it's also a great opportunity for you to invite someone that you know that would really benefit from having some personal healing prayer as well. We're going to continue to do our master planning updates and talking about some of the ideas. As you're walking through the gathering space, you might be able to see some of those ideas on the walls. So there have been two meetings that have been scheduled that are the same ones that were last week. So it's going to be, we're going to continue to kind of talk about these things. December 3rd at 5:45, that's a transition time of some of our youth music ministry. So that's going to be in the gathering space on Sunday at 5:45. And then Monday, December 4th at 6:30, and that's going to be up in room 237. So if you'd like to hear some more about some of our master planning process and some of the ideas we've come up with, be sure to check out those meetings. Please take a look at your Trinity Day for all of the other announcements. We have a couple of announcements related to our family here. Pearl Weaver, who passed away on August 8th, the memorial service has been scheduled now for December 3rd at 3 p.m. In the chapel. And also we received word yesterday that Clay Reynolds passed away, and his memorial service has yet to be determined. Please stand for the confession. Let us approach God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit with a true heart in full assurance of God's power to heal, to hear, and to forgive sins. Merciful God, you have loved your people from the beginning of time, desiring that we also love you and our neighbor with fullness of heart. We confess that we often seek wealth or security for ourselves without acting generously toward others. Forgive us and point us in your ways that we might reflect your will for us and your creation. Amen. God promises that everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. I declare to you the forgiveness of all of your sins. Amen. Let us pray. Righteous God, our merciful Master, you own the earth and all its peoples, and you give us all that we have. Inspire us to serve you with justice and wisdom, and prepare us for the joy of the day of your coming. through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Please be seated for the readings. Lord, through all the generations, you have been our home. You turn people back to dust, saying, "Return to dust." You sweep people away like dreams that disappear, or like grass that springs up in the morning. We wither beneath your anger. We are overwhelmed by your fury. We live our lives beneath your wrath. We end our lives with a groan. Who can comprehend the power of your anger? Your wrath is awesome as the fear you deserve.
Children are invited to come up for a story. The name of my story this morning is Do Your Best. Last night, Uncle Floyd was just about done making the vegetable soup for supper when the phone rang. And it was a call from the church. He's the sexton at his church, by the way. It was a call from the church saying there was an emergency with the heating system and he needed to go over right away. So he quickly told Barabbas and Gator and Francis that he was leaving. "I reckon you will need to do the dishes, Barabbas. And Gator, you sweep up the floor afterwards. And Francis, I would like you to make sure that all the leftover food gets put in the refrigerator. I won't be home until late. See you in the morning." And he grabbed his coat and he left. So the three of them sat down when everything was ready and they had their soup. And before they ate, they said their usual supper time prayer. And then after the soup was gone, they had their apple pie that Uncle Floyd had made earlier in the afternoon, and they had a scoop of ice cream on top of the pie. And afterwards, Barabbas rinsed all the dishes off and at the sink, and then he put them in the dishwasher. We'll pretend this is the dishwasher. And he got the table all cleaned up. And after he cleaned up the table, he wiped off the countertop and got everything. He even cleaned up the stovetop. And he noticed that Francis hadn't put away the soup yet from dinner, so Barabbas himself just put it in the bowl and set it in the refrigerator for Francis. Now, when everything was being cleaned up, Gator swept the floor, and after he swept the floor, which is what Uncle Floyd asked him to do, he got out the mop and he mopped the floor because there was some flour that had spilled here in front of the counter when Uncle Floyd was making that pie crust earlier. And then he decided, well, he should just go in and do the bathroom too, because that was near the kitchen. And when he was cleaning the bathroom floor, he thought to himself, "Wow, I've never considered the splash factor when there are four guys living in the house." And about 8:30, Barabbas and Gator went up to 8:30 when the game was over. Barabbas and Gator went up because Francis had gone out to watch TV instead of doing his chores. He was watching the Penn State and Nebraska game. And so Gator and Barabbas got in bed and they talked with each other and they read some books and they turned off the light when it was time. And so it was about midnight when Uncle Floyd got back home from church and there was Francis asleep on the Lazy Boy with the TV blaring. And Uncle Floyd went out to the kitchen and got a bowl of soup and heated it up in the microwave and came out in the living room to talk with Francis. And he turned the TV off, and Francis woke up with a start. And he said, "Oh, jeepers, I forgot to put the soup away." And he ran to the kitchen. Of course, it was already put away. So he said, "Oh, I guess one of the boys did that already." Uncle Floyd, who had admired the good work that had been done in the kitchen, thought to himself, "Well, I guess that Gator and Barabbas did the work themselves without any help from Francis." And he was proud of Gator and Barabbas, but he was a little bit disappointed in the behavior from Francis, who appeared to have done nothing. Sometimes when we do not get around to the work that we should have done to help other people, maybe God is disappointed with us. Let's work together to do God's work with our hands. The end.
Hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah.
Gospel of Matthew, the 25th chapter. Jesus was speaking to the disciples and said, "For it is as if a man going on a journey summoned his slaves and entrusted his property to them. To one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, to another 1, to each according to his ability. Then he went away. The one who had received the 5 talents went off at once and traded with them and made 5 more talents. In the same way, the one who had 2 talents made 2 more talents. But the one who had received the 1 talent went off and dug a hole in the ground and hid his master's money. After a long time, the master of those slaves came and settled accounts with them. Then the one who had received the 5 talents came forward, bringing 5 more talents, saying, 'Master, you handed over to me 5 talents. See, I have made 5 more talents. His master said to him, "Well done, good and trustworthy slave. You have been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master.' And the one with the 2 talents came forward also, saying, 'Master, you handed over to me 2 talents. See, I have made 2 more talents. His master said to him, "Well done, good and trustworthy slave. You have been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master.' Then the one who had received the 1 talent also came forward, saying, 'Master, I knew that you were a harsh man, reaping where you did not sow and gathering where you did not scatter seed. So I was afraid, and I went and hid your talent in the ground. Here you have what is yours.' But his master replied, 'You wicked and lazy slave, you knew, did you, that I reap where I did not sow and gather where I did not scatter? Then to have invested my money with the bankers, and on my return I would have received what was my own with interest. So take the talent from him and give it to the one with the 10 talents. For to all those who have, more will be given, and they will have an abundance. But from those who have nothing, even what they have will be taken away. As for this worthless slave, throw him into the outer darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth." The Gospel of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Grace to you and peace from God who is, who was, and who is to come. Amen. Thanks be to God with that gospel reading. I have to tell you, I struggle with this parable. I'm not certain that I totally understand it, and if I do understand it correctly, I'm not sure that I like the conclusion. But let me walk us through it. So in the midst of the parables that we've been hearing the last few weeks, last week we had the parable of the 10 bridesmaids. Next week we're going to hear the parable of the separation of the sheep and the goats. We get this parable of Jesus saying that there's this unnamed businessman, apparently very wealthy businessman, and he's going on a trip. But before he leaves, he does this rather odd thing, or at least it's odd by our modern standards. He calls 3 of his employees in, and he entrusts each of them with a significant amount of money. Now, in first century terms, the word talent was a financial term. It doesn't really translate well into our modern understanding because the word itself has changed its meaning. But according to a footnote in one of my study Bibles, a talent was equivalent to 15 years' worth of wages. Yes, 15, 1, 5. So we're talking about a lot of bucks here. The businessman, he calls these three employees and he gives each of them a different amount. So quick little bit of math. According to the U.S. Census Bureau September report, the 2016 real median household income in the U.S. was $59,039. I'm going to round that down just a little bit to make it for easy math. So that means that 15 years times 59,000 equals $885,000. That's what employee number three is entrusted with. Number two, he got 59,000 times 15 times two talents. He gets $1,170,000. Employee number one, 15 years times 59,000 times five, he gets $4,425,000. Any of your bosses done that for you lately? Yeah. Now, as far as we can determine, these employees receive this funds for no other reason than safekeeping. They're not given any direction as to what, if anything, they are supposed to do with these rather significant amounts of money. Boss goes away, doesn't say how long he's going to be gone, doesn't say where he's going to be gone, and then he returns. And he wants an accounting of how they have invested his money, because apparently that's what they were supposed to do. He never came out and said that, though. So what's surprising to me is that that's what the employees did. They went out and invested their employer's money. They took risks. They used the funds to buy and sell. Well, two of the three did. The third one, the one who was given the least amount, he took an extremely cautious approach to his boss's money, and he buried it in the ground. So the boss comes back. He wants an accounting. Employee number one comes forward and says, "Sir, you handed me five bars. Look, through my financial dealings, I've doubled your funds." "Well done, good and faithful slave. You have been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things." Number two comes forward. "Sir, I've done the same scenario. I've done the same thing. I was able to invest your money. I've doubled it for you. Here you go, sir. Well done, good and trustworthy slave. You have been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things." Let me stop right there for a moment. Have you ever asked anyone to take care of your money, you know, somebody to help you with an IRA or maybe a 401k or you know, even Jenny behind the counter at Members First, whatever. We expect whatever monies that we put into those accounts, hopefully, is going to grow, right? Maybe a little, hopefully a lot. But, you know, say that I hand my wallet to a friend while I'm going to go out on the court and play a quick pickup game of basketball. I'm not going to do that, trust me. But say I were to do that, and when I get done with that pickup game and I go back to my friend to get my wallet, what I am not expecting that friend to say is, "Oh, John, by the way, you know, while you were out doing that, I hope you don't mind. I opened up your wallet. I took $20 out. I went down to the dollar store. I bought a whole bunch of soda. I came back here. I sold it, and look at this. I doubled your money. Here's your $40. I am not going to say to that person, "Hey, that was a great idea. Why don't you keep that $40? I can really relate to employee number three. And even more so when he talks about what kind of a guy his boss is. "Master, I knew that you were a harsh man, reaping where you did not sow, gathering where you did not scatter. I was afraid and I hid your money in the ground. Here." Now, maybe you might go out on vacation and ask me to watch your car for 3 months. I might drive it around town a few times just to make sure the battery stays charged and the brakes don't freeze up. I'm not going to take your car on a cross-country trip. The cautious approach that number three takes infuriates his boss, who not only takes the money from number three and gives it to number one, but he tosses number three out onto the street, no pension, no parachute, no package, nothing. So what are we supposed to do with this story? Now, most of the commentaries that I read said that the original hearers of this parable would have instinctively known that the master was code for God, and that the servants were actually the believers, the people of Israel, and that the money invested by the servants was code for the message of God. So if we bring that analogy all the way forward to 21st century North America, then we, as the believers, are given the message of Christ, that is the good news, and we're supposed to go out and share that message. We're supposed to go out and tell others about God's grace and love and strength and forgiveness, which in turn means if we don't tell others about the gospel, that is, if we act like servant number three and bury that treasure in the ground, keep it to ourselves, that's the kind of thing that really ticks off God. That lack of action annoys God to the point where we would hear this, "As for this worthless slave, throw him into the outer darkness where there is weeping and gnashing of teeth." Jeez. So what concerns me, though, about this parable, am I doing that? Am I spreading that treasure, investing it, giving the gospel message to those who need to hear it? Or to put it another way, how many people have I brought into this congregation? How many folks have I shared my faith with, especially to the point where they have made a life change, a faith commitment? All right, maybe you're sitting there thinking, well, you know, geez, Brock, you're standing up in front of us every week, you know, the leading worshiper yapping away. Of course, you know, you're doing this. And I got to disagree with that, because personally, I think most of you don't count, because you're coming here anyway. You've already got faith. And if you don't, and you've been coming here for a while, well, we got bigger problems. But let me ask this uncomfortable question. How many people are active in this congregation because of you? How many members have you brought here to Trinity? Or let me make it a little easier. How many people in general, let's take it outside of Trinity, how many people in general, other than those to whom you are biologically related, how many people are active in their Christian faith because of you? I think that's the point of this parable. It's not about money. It's not about wealth or personal gain. It's not even about how well do we follow vague directions. No, I think the point of this parable, what have you done? What have I done to increase the body of Christ and to bring others into the fold? How have you invested the faith that you have been given? That's the question that each of us is asked. And sisters and brothers, I got to tell you, on that question, I think each of us is left wanting. Amen.
In baptism, our gracious Heavenly Father frees us from sin and death by joining us to the death and resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. We are born children of a fallen humanity. By water and the Holy Spirit, we are reborn children of God and made members of the church, the body of Christ. living with Christ and in communion of saints, we grow in faith, love, and obedience to the will of God. Called by the Holy Spirit, trusting in the grace and love of God, do you desire to have Charlotte May baptized into Christ? If so, answer, I do.
I do.
As you bring Charlotte May to receive the gifts of baptism, you are entrusted with responsibilities to live with her among God's faithful people, to bring her to the Word of God and the Holy Supper, to teach her the Lord's Prayer, the Creed, and the Ten Commandments, to place in her hands the Holy Scriptures, to nurture her in faith and prayer so that she may learn to trust God, proclaim Christ through word and deed, and to care for others in the world God made, and to work for justice and peace. Do you promise to help her grow in the Christian faith and life? If so, answer, I do. People of God, do you promise to support Charlotte May and pray for her in her new life in Christ? If so, answer, we do. We do. I ask you to profess your faith in Christ Jesus, reject sin, and confess the faith of the church. Please stand. Do you renounce the devil and all the forces that defy God? If so, answer, I renounce them. Do you renounce the powers of this world that rebel against God? If so, answer, I renounce them. Do you renounce the ways of sin that draw you from God? If so, answer, I renounce them. Do you believe in God the Father? I believe in God the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. Do you believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God? I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. Do you believe in God, the Holy Spirit? I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. We give you thanks, O God, for in the beginning your Spirit moved over the waters, and by your word you created the world, calling forth life in which you took delight. Through the waters of the flood you delivered Noah and his family, and through the sea you led your people Israel from slavery into freedom. At the river your Son was baptized by John and anointed with the Holy Spirit. By the baptism of Jesus' death and resurrection you set us free from the power of sin and death and raise us up to live in you. Pour out your Holy Spirit, the power of your living word, that those who are washed in the waters of baptism may be given new life. To you be given honor and praise through Jesus Christ our Lord, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. Could you hold this for me? Thank you. You ready? Please be seated. Charlotte, may I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. There you go. There you go. Okay. You can hold her up now. Yep. Let us pray. We give you thanks, O God, that through water and the Holy Spirit you give your daughters and sons new birth. Cleanse them from sin and raise them to eternal life. You want to bring her to me? Thank you. No, go ahead. Sustain Charlotte May with the gift of your Holy Spirit, the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and fear of the Lord, and the spirit of joy in your presence, both now and forever. Amen. Charlotte May, child of God, you are sealed with the Holy Spirit and marked with the cross of Christ forever. Amen. Thank you very much. There you go. Let your light so shine before others that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven. Amen. Let us welcome the newly baptized.
I'll take a moment. Father, be with the Father of Christ, and if you wish to share, join us in giving thanks.
It's my pleasure to welcome our new sister in Christ, Charlotte May. Yeah, yay! Kid will be preaching in about 26 years. Please stand for the prayers. As we welcome God's reign of righteousness and mercy, let us pray with people of every time and place. We pray for the church. Enliven our ministries. Open our hearts to share that faith. Open our mouths to share God's good news. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for those who are recovering from natural disasters and attacks of human hatred. Guide us who have not been harmed to reach out in your compassion and strength to those who are in need of aid. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for those who suffer from illness of body, heart, mind, or spirit. Surround them with your powerful presence, O Lord. We lift up John Shannon, George Thompson, Bill Pines, Elizabeth Winters, Marion Mackley, Robin Koshiba, the Reynolds family, and all those we name in our hearts or on our lips. Lord, in your mercy, we pray for this congregation and the talents and treasures that each person brings. Help us to encourage and build up one another as today we remember our Trinity sisters and brothers, Doug and Doreen Templeton, William, Jaina, and Alexis Temple, Bob and Sue Telford, Melissa, Tristan, Genevieve, and Logan Taylor, Matt, Marjorie, Vivian, Lana, and Marley Taylor, Dave, Kelly, Mason, and Dylan Taylor, Cole, Shannon, Allison, and Rowan Taylor, Chris, Kim, Aiden, and Cameron Taylor, and Charlotte Barrow. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, you are our dwelling place in all generations. We remember with thanksgiving all those who have died in you, especially Clay Reynolds. Teach us to count our days as a gift from you. Lord, in your mercy. Receive these prayers and the hopes and concerns of our hearts, O God, as we entrust into your loving care all for whom we pray through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us share God's peace. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. Peace the Lord. Peace be with you. God's peace. Peace be with you.
Peace be with you. Peace be with you. Congratulations. With the actions of this offering, we tell your story, how you have dealt generously with us, how you have met our needs, how you have heard our prayers, how your goodness is from everlasting to everlasting. Bless these offerings which we made in the name of Christ. Amen. Christ is here. With joy, we lift up our hearts. We praise you, O God, for creating the universe. With great care, you set the earth in its place and filled it with life. Through your prophets, you promised a day of justice when the hungry would be fed, a day of faithfulness when your law would be written on our hearts. When we failed to live faithfully in the old covenant, you sent Jesus to establish a new one. He offered himself on the cross, and you raised him to life again, opening for us a new way into your presence. In this meal before us, your Son becomes food for our hungry hearts and nourishes us for eternal life. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. God fills the hungry with good things. Let us come to the feast.
We pray for blessings. We pray for peace, comfort for family, protection while we sleep. We pray for healing, for prosperity. We pray for your mighty hand to ease our suffering, and all us lesser things. 'Cause what if your blessings come through raindrops? What if your healing comes through tears? And what if a thousand sleepless nights are what it takes to know you're near? And what if trials of this life are your mercies in disguise? storms the heart.
body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Let us pray. Mighty God, you are our fortress who leads us in mission and ministry to serve our neighbor in need. Thank you for your presence in this meal of love that unites and empowers us to worship, connect, and serve. To you be all glory and honor. Amen. May the gracious gift of the Lord God be upon you and increase the work of your hands. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever. Amen.
Jesus, hope of the nations, Jesus, comfort for all who mourn. You are the source of heaven's hope on earth. Jesus, light in the darkness, Jesus, truth in each circumstance.
Serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.
We will.